Next on the bench is a one of Hermle's movements. It's the 1161-853. I believe it's an AS. And it comes with the second hand as well as three winding arbors. It's cable driven, so brass spring wire. And it no longer functions, but it also was kind of rudely used. I guess you can see the bend in the dial mask here. As the unit was taken out and put back into the clock, someone didn't realize they had to remove the keepers on the back there that keep that from vibrating or flush up against the mask. And since they forgot about it, they pulled the unit out, and a lot of Howard Millers use this, but this particular company probably OEM'd it from Howard Miller, and they put their name on it, the Steinway Company clockmakers, just to give it a more personal touch. And made in USA, which would be the higher end Hermle movements, they use a little bit of this embossed scroll work here. I don't know if you can see that. Let's get a close-up. Made for the Viking Clock Company by the Hermle Black Forest Clock. 1161-853 AS. It has a 94 centimeter pendulum, and that's pretty much all that you need to know from the back of this guy. All we need to do first to get the dial off, hopefully you can see, this is the back of the dial here. The dial has got these posts on it. It's got four posts, two on top and two on the bottom, and they all get released exactly the same way on this movement. You simply push away these levers and that unhooks the post. Also, these two fly governors, even though they seem the same, they're actually different. Make sure that you put the correct ones back exactly where they came from. And to get this little guy off, this little set screw behind here. Okay, this lever is held in by this little...
I get it.
Okay. All right, we're still taking off the A-frame here. We got one screw out so far. The A-frame not only holds the pendulum up, but it also gives a pivot area for the verge. So when we take this off, this slides away like this. And then the verge comes out. The verge is kind of interesting to get out because you got to twist and wiggle and jiggle, and out she comes. And here's the verge. It almost shows no sign of wear whatsoever, but it is oily with very thick oil, which can stop the clock. It used to be clock oil, and now it's differential oil. So, since it has a clutch in it with plastic, never put this through the ultrasonic. Now we've got everything photographed, what we're going to do is to take all of these components out and put it into the ultrasonic rack. And maybe I'll just get rid of these hammers out of it to make room for all these parts. You can always add all these components.
I usually put through the entire rack assembled through the ultrasonic, knowing that I'm going to be taking it apart to doing a full cleaning. And the reason I put it through is not because of the inside where the dirt is. I put it through to match the color of all of these rods with all of the other clean components like the plates and everything else that you see. If I didn't put it through, then it would look darker and it would look like I missed it. And trying to hand clean or hand polish something like this will take at least an hour.
Because if you burnish these things, there is a little fine layer of plating on here, nickel plating. And it's going to come off. So what you've done is made a perfectly clean pivot that's going to fail within a couple of months. So just polish it, don't ruin the plating, and you'll be fine. In case you find a pivot that looks all cracked up and it just feels rough, the plating could be coming off already. And your choices in that matter is either
First of all, you can buy this wheel brand new from the manufacturer. They still make it. Or you can cut off that pivot, put in a hardened steel pivot yourself within a 10 minutes or so once you get used to doing it. The worst thing you could do is to use a burnisher or some a pivot file and scratch off all of the plating to get to the metal underneath, because the metal underneath is kind of porous and it's very weak. And that's why they plated it, so they could use very cheap metal inside the pivots there. And the chrome on, the nickel plating on the outside is extremely hard, and that makes a good pivot surface. But once you take off that extremely hard surface, you then have very crappy metal underneath. It might even be porous for all I know. And it will chew through your bushings like a rasp file. And within 6 months, you're going to have a completely worn out bushing and a very unhappy customer. So that's not an option. So you can replace the wheel, you can replace the pivot, and believe it or not, there is another thing you can do now. You can call up Butterworth, Mark Butterworth, at ButterworthClocks.com. And he'll sell you a ball bearing that the inner race will fit this pivot. Sometimes you got to put a little bushing inside the ball bearing to fit the pivot. And it's a very loose fit, just like the pivot goes into the plate, except it'll go into the ball bearing. You cut an extra larger hole for the ball bearing in the plates, and you glue it in using the bearing retainer compound from Loctite. And he gives full instructions on how to do that. They have a millimeter outside diameter. And you can leave the boogered up pivot, because it will never cause a problem inside that ball bearing. The ball bearing is what turns inside of itself. The pivot and the bearing, the brass bushing, or the inside of the ball bearing, will turn together. So you can have a bunch of ruined pivots, and you can save the movement. So there's your third choice. The thing to do is
start some bushing work, and I'm going to be using a KWM bushing machine. But you can do the bushing work by hand just by following the instructions that I have on my YouTube page. It shows you how to do it by hand, and you can purchase just about anything that you need from ButterworthClocks.com. And he sells all the bushings. He might be selling the brooches by now, as well as any of the reamers or drill bits or bushings, whether they be KWM or Bergeon sizes. You can even buy them in blind bushings. So depending on what your budget is and how you plan on doing bushings, you can always email me when you get to that particular point, and we can talk about it to find out what would be the most economical way for you to proceed. For me, time is money, and spending a few hundred dollars on a bushing machine with all of the different adapters, a machine like this pretty much pays for itself within a couple of weeks worth of usage. So the main thing is that we get clocks in and we pump clocks out completely finished and ready to go for the next 15 to 20 years.
In order to get started for this operation, first we have to locate center of the pivots, because once you lose center, it'll be very difficult to get it back. That's a whole other video that I need to do on how to relocate centers. The main thing is that you are careful to begin with, and that you find out where your centers are. And what I use is a preacher, just a piece of steel about 1 inch square, and then I put in 3 bolts. It doesn't matter exactly where you put them, and mark one of them red. I would prefer to mark this one red over here, which is by itself, instead of this one. And then the one that you mark red, leave it slightly longer than the other two. And the reason for that is that the red one falls into a hole on the main plate. And since it falls into a hole, you want to make it a little bit longer to compensate for that. And after you got it in there, just tap twice and it puts two completely tiny little divots into the plate. Unless you're looking for them, you would not think anything of those two little marks. And we'll just go ahead and do the rest of them. And what happens is this cone shape that you make on a lathe and you get a perfectly centered point, it finds the biggest hole inside the pivot. The biggest hole is the factory hole. The smaller hole, which is the growth hole, where the pivot has cut sideways into, is smaller, so the little cone shape will not seek that out. Let me get this thing recentered here. Take the plates apart here. And I might as well go ahead and run the countersink for all of them that I had fixed up to get the flashing out of the way. Okay, we have the seconds hand, and it has that tiny little microscopic little spring washer there. Whatever you do, don't lose it. I'm going to take it off because I want to polish the area. I put it down on the table just now. First, what we're going to do is to put on the chime select lever. It comes in from the front with a little peg, and then the little ratchet assembly that gets mounted on there. This is the top of the unit right here. This is the chime side. This lever, with all those crazy bends in it, it goes into this little hole here, and that little collar comes in from the inside and fastens it so it doesn't pull back out again. Okay. It doesn't have a C-clip or anything. This lever here is what hits the flags on the minute arbor. It's got a little pin that sticks down and it rides there. So as the minute arbor is turning, see the way it clicks up and drops down? The proper position for the gathering pallet is that this little flag right here, I'm going to touch it right here, this little flag which goes into this hole, the pin on that wheel, I guess that's the second wheel down from the top, has to hit the bottom. Before I forget, let's go ahead and put some grease on the areas that need grease. First one is that ratchet. You might be able to see that. That little ratchet that's doing that right now. We definitely want to put some grease on that. Okay, the Westminster chime position is all the way on the bottom on this particular movement, and it's four positions. You got St. Michael's one click up, Whittington, I believe, and then off. When you come out of off, it'll probably start to go into chiming, but you don't really have to care about that. It'll self-synchronize. I'm going to put it back on. Movement turned around now on my test stand. And whenever you're moving these weights around and grabbing them, make sure that you wear gloves. You don't want to have any of the oils on your hand getting onto the brass, because a year later your fingerprints will be permanently etched on there and it looks ugly. Next is adjust these Geneva stops right here. And the way they're supposed to work is you only have to adjust one side, either the top or the bottom. I like doing the top. What you do is that you run up the weight until it comes up to the area that you want to have it come up to and no further, because these are such ornate weights that you want to have them showing. Also, because they're as heavy as they are, they don't have to go down too far before they run out of cable. So what you do, or at least what I do, is that I run it up to the height that I want, and then I adjust. Let me see if I can set up the Geneva stops, and I set it the pendulum in motion, and you notice the way I have a huge amount of swing on it right now. I purposely did that so the autocorrect mechanism built into that verge, remember that the verge itself is sitting on a clutch. And that pretty much takes care of this one. We have, this is a Hermle 1161-853 AX, I believe. And we brought it back to life. And it's going to go back to the customer site now. I also adjusted the moon gear. So it is hitting its drive associated moon driver gears back there. So that was off very slightly. Okay, this is Al Takatsch with Jefferson ClockWorks and signing off.